So, as Nicolas said, my name is Abdel Basset Abaidia, and I'm the substitute of Greg. So Greg was programmed to come, but unfortunately, he's with the French national team. So we had to do a substitution, and I'm going to do the presentation. So before the World Cup, just to explain you the context, I've been asked to perform a recovery protocol for the national team, for the French national team. So in this presentation, I'm gonna show you the process we used in order to define and implement this protocol. So first, we had to focus on the context of professional football players. As you know, these players are exposed to a large number of matches during a season. So the in-season period lasts approximately 42 weeks, and players have to participate to national games, but also European games. In addition, when they play for the national team, they have to play international matches, which represents around 10 matches per season. So the consequence is that 80 to 82 matches are played during a season, which represent 28 to 32 weeks with 2 matches per week. So in this context, the recovery period between 2 matches is between 2 and 4 days. So a question that arises is, how much time does a professional player need to fully recover? So is this period between 2 matches enough for the player to fully recover? So to answer this question, we're gonna ask scientific literature, and some studies have focused on recovery kinetics after a soccer match. The results of these studies showed that at least 4 days are needed in order to fully recover when we focus on performance parameters. So what are the consequences of this congested fixture on injury and performance? So Greg Dupont and et al. Performed a study in order to analyze the effects of playing 2 soccer matches in a week on injury rate. The results showed that injury incidence is 6 times higher when we play 2 matches per week in comparison with 1 match. It has been hypothesized that recovery period, so between 2 and 4 days, between 2 matches is insufficient to fully recover and leads to an increase of injury. These results have been confirmed by other studies, and we wanted to check this hypothesis, and for that, we conducted a pilot study in which we analyzed the possible relationship between recovery and the occurrence of injury. So for that, we performed this study with a French team playing in the Ligue 1 during 3 seasons, so from 2013 to 2016. 46 professional players were involved in this study, and we have implemented a recovery monitoring protocol when 2 matches were played in a week, at least 2 matches. So the protocol was as follows: the players were tested every day between 2 matches. They were tested on subjective questionnaires, so we asked them their level of sleep, soreness, fatigue, and stress using a Hooper scale from 1, graduated from 1 to 7. We also assessed perception of recovery using a scale from 0 to 10. We have also evaluated sleep with subjective questionnaires, so the quantity of sleep, time to bed, time to wake up, and sleep onset latency. We have evaluated the level of blood concentrations of creatine kinase, And for performance, we have tested the players on counter movement jump 8 and maximal voluntary contraction of the knee flexors with an isometric test. So what were the results? So the results showed that the overall incidence was 12.5 injuries per mil hour of practice. During the matches, we found 29 injuries, and among these 29 injuries, 20 were non-contact injuries. What about the parameters of recovery kinetics? So we found an association between the level of fatigue, muscle soreness, and isometric force with the occurrence of injury. So when this threshold, when the level of fatigue, muscle soreness, and isometric test was higher than this threshold, the risk of injury was increased. So 1 day, 2 days, and 3 days after the match. So what to do? These results indicate that a bad recovery is associated with a higher risk of injury. So to cope with this risk, we have two solutions. The first one is to rotate the players. However, as you know, in top elite team, it's difficult to rotate the players at each match. So it's not the best solution for practical settings. The second solution is to optimize the recovery between matches, and this is the most appropriate solution with the aim of regaining a level of physical performance faster and also reducing the injury risk. So to know which strategy we can use, we have first to study what are the fatigue mechanisms involved during a soccer match. So it has been proposed that dehydration, glycogen depletion, muscle damage, and mental fatigue are involved in this mechanism. However, glycogen depletion and muscle damage are the main factors that may influence fatigue during a soccer match. In addition, we need to know what are the actions performed during a match that may influence the level of fatigue during the match. So studies have focused on this topic, and their results showed that straight line running is not associated with recovery kinetics of performance markers. Additionally, from a quantitative point of view, running performance does not appear to be the main factor that influences fatigue during a match. However, we have other parameters that may influence the level of fatigue. A study of Nedelec et al. Showed that there is an association between the number of sprints when the distance is less than 5 meters and changes of direction with recovery kinetics of counter movement jump, sprint performance, and also the level of muscle soreness. It indicates that the most you do sprints less than 5 meters or changes of direction, the less the recovery will be. This can be explained by the fact that these movements are constituted by acceleration and deceleration, which are constituted by eccentric contractions leading to muscle damage. There are also several factors that may impair recovery. An increase of stress may decrease recovery kinetics of strength 96 hours following heavy resistance exercise. In addition, sleep deprivation have been shown to have detrimental effects on the immune system and glycogen resynthesis. Moreover, sleep deprivation can increase the inflammatory response and increase the level of muscle soreness. Lastly, sleep deprivation decreases the cognitive function, which is very important for football players. So Sleep deprivation is a very important issue for soccer players, as most of the matches are played at night. A recent survey showed that 95% of the players questioned indicated worse sleep in the night after night matches. This is characterized by a late time to go to bed and a low sleep duration, and also a high sleep latency. In addition, in this context, players are exposed to an increased risk of injuries. Our studies have shown that injury risk is 1.7 times higher when sleep duration is lower than 8 hours in comparison with sleep duration higher than 8 hours during the night. So now, from a practical point of view, we want to know what are the efficient recovery strategies in order to reduce the magnitude of fatigue and to accelerate recovery following a match. For that, Nedel et al. Have performed a study in which they have questioned 32 practitioners from the French football teams playing in the Ligue 1. They ask the following questions: what are the recovery strategies you use with your players? The results showed that a lot of strategies were used, among them nutrition, sleep, cold water immersion, contrast water therapy, active recovery, massage, stretching, electrostimulation, and compression garments. However, we can ask, and one question that arises is, what is the scientific evidence justifying these recovery strategies? In other words, are these recovery strategies efficient in order to accelerate recovery? So this is the question we have asked before performing the recovery protocol. To answer this question, we define the level of scientific evidence. For that, we analyzed for each recovery strategy the level of scientific evidence using a methodological quality checklist. So we focused on mostly on meta-analysis and systematic reviews, and when it was not possible, we used randomized control trials. So once the level of scientific evidence was defined, we gave a grade of recommendation using a specific grid. You have here, so we had 4 levels, A, B, C, D. So A was the highest level of recommendation. So we used, to analyze systematic reviews and meta-analysis, the AMSTAR tool, which is a methodological quality checklist graduated from 1 to 11. So what were the results of this analysis? So first, we just to specify, we focused only on physical performance to determine the usefulness of recovery strategies. So regarding recovery strategies, nutrition and hydration were the most important recovery strategies according to the majority of the French football teams. However, what is the scientific evidence justifying this use? So we found 6 systematic reviews dealing with this aspect, and the high score of the reviews was 6.11, indicating a moderate level of methodological quality. So the level of evidence was high because we had several systematic reviews with a moderate level of quality, and the grade of recommendation was A, meaning that this strategy was efficient to accelerate recovery. However, how can you implement nutrition and hydration following a match? So as 24 to 72 hours are needed to the glycogen resynthesis following a match, it is recommended to consume carbohydrate rapidly after the match, within the first hour of the match, after the match and to consume high glycemic index meal. In addition, we can consume carbohydrate added with certain amino acids and proteins. Regarding rehydration, it is recommended to consume 1.5 times the sweet loss with the water having a high level of sodium concentration. This aspect is important as there is an influence of dehydration on glycogen synthesis. However, dehydration has a limited role on fatigue during a soccer match. And additionally, drinking too much water after the match may lead to sleep disturbances with a lot of waking during the night. So we have to find a balance between the need to rehydrate and the need to optimize sleep. So regarding protein consumption, it is recommended to consume proteins during the 2 hours following a match in order to repair muscle damage induced by the exercise. Additionally, protein consumption has beneficial effects on subsequent performance and markers of muscle damage. Specifically, we can also consume milk chocolate. It has been shown that this aliment have beneficial effect on recovery kinetics of performance and also muscle soreness and sleep latency. Moreover, some juice with cherry or berry, when consumed chronically before and after the game, may also accelerate recovery kinetics. So this was for nutrition. The second recovery strategy is sleep, and it was considered as very important for the majority of the teams. However, for sleep, we didn't find any systematic review dealing with the relationship between sleep and recovery kinetics. We found only randomized controlled trials. So the level of scientific evidence was 2+, which is a high level of scientific evidence, and the grade of recommendation was B, so to accept the fact that sleep is an important recovery strategy after a soccer match. So to optimize sleep, we have to limit the exposition to short wavelength light after a match. These lights are the blue and the green, and they impair melatonin secretion and have a bad effect on sleep. So for that, we can use glasses in order to protect from these kind of lights, and the aim is to decrease the light from the screens of electronic devices. The third recovery strategy is cold water immersion. This strategy is the one with the highest level of scientific evidence, as we had systematic reviews with a high level of methodological quality. So the grade of recommendation, of course, is A, in order to accept this recovery strategy as efficient after a match. Studies and several meta-analyses have shown beneficial effects of cold water immersion on performance parameters. It is recommended to immerse the whole body instead of immersing only the exercised limb. The effects are more pronounced when we do the cold water immersion every day after the match, and it is recommended to immerse the body at 10 to 12 degrees during 10 minutes approximately. So what about compression garments? So compression garments has a specific status. As you can see, only 22% of the teams declared using compression garments. However, when we do the scientific analysis analysis of this effect, we found three systematic reviews with a high level of methodological quality, so a high level of scientific evidence and a grade of recommendation A, showing that compression garments have beneficial effects on recovery kinetics of strength performance. So it's a strategy which is not used a lot by clubs, but when we want to have an evidence-based approach, we can see that this strategy is effective to accelerate recovery. So now I have a question for you. There is a lot of physiotherapists, and my question is about massage. So people in this room who think massage is efficient to accelerate recovery, please put your hands up in the air. Not a lot. If you think there's no effect, put your hands up in the air. Okay, a little more. So the others, you're waiting the slide. Okay, no problem. I give you the answer. So first, from a scientific point of view, we found a high level of scientific evidence about the effect of massage and a grade of recommendation B. However, these effects are real on muscle soreness. Regarding performance, we found contradictory results, meaning that we cannot say if there is an effect or not. So we cannot recommend this strategy in order to accelerate recovery performance. We can recommend for muscle soreness, but as I said before, we focused on physical performance. So massage for physical performance cannot be defined as an efficient recovery strategy. However, contrary to compression garment, which was an efficient strategy, massage is used by the majority of the teams. Regarding active recovery, stretching and electrostimulation, we found a high level of scientific evidence to reject the use of these strategies. It means that active recovery, stretching, and electrostimulation have no effect or no beneficial effect on recovery kinetics of physical performance. So now we have analyzed the level of scientific evidence for each recovery strategies, and we have to implement the recovery protocol. So we said that massage, stretching, active recovery, and electrostimulation may be removed from this protocol, as the level of scientific evidence was not enough to accept these recovery strategies. So to conclude, this is an example of a recovery protocol to implement after a match. And this is the protocol we used with the French football team during the World Cup. So immediately after the match, players may start the rehydration process. Then they can add to that tart cherry juice and milk chocolate before going to the cold bath and before eating a meal with a high glycemic index carbohydrate and a large amount of proteins. In addition, players can wear compression garments during the night, and the most important is to optimize sleep by adapting the environment of the players by shutting off the lights and limiting exposure to screens. Thank you for your attention.